It is a very strange thing that Muslimin today take great pride in the last 10 days of Ramadan. We, you know, fast very diligently. We keep all our sadaqah for the last 10 nights of Ramadan. We, alhamdulillah, stay up most of the nights. And of course, the 27th, we pay a lot of attention, if not the odd days or odd nights of that of the last 10 nights. We also, of course, do i'tikaf, and we try and do an umrah if we can. We do all types of good deeds. But what about the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah? What about these 10 days about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly told us that they are the best days of the year? So much so has He told us that actually He has sworn by the nights of these 10 days to show you the greatness of the days. If He has sworn by the nights, then what about the days? وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. And I swear by the night of the 10 nights of the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And then وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتَرِ. وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتَرِ, what is that? I swear by the day of Arafah, which is an odd day, and then the even day, which is the day of slaughtering. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sworn by all of the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah because it is so great in the eyes of Allah azza wa jal. And what can show you the greatness of it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down in the last third of the night in all of the nights of the calendar, right? But in a daytime, He doesn't come down to the last heavens except on one day, and that is the day of Arafah. On the day of Arafah, Allah Rabbana Jalla Jalalu descends to the last heavens and comes close to us, and then He boasts about the people of Arafah to Allah, to the people that are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, it is actually madness to actually overlook the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. It is madness. Because, you know, we don't know which day is the Laylatul Qadr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hid that, and He has taken that knowledge away. And of course, many of the ulama have done ijtihad, and some say 27th is the most probable, if not the other odd nights. But in the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, He hasn't hidden which day is the day of Arafah. He's told us exactly, alhamdulillah, the 9th day is the day of Arafah. Alhamdulillah, Allah Rabbana Jalla Jalalu has told us that day. And so He has told us that particular day, Allah Azza wa Jal forgives and He accepts dua. Until it was reported that the Salaf, the righteous, pious predecessors, they used to prepare the whole year for the dua of Arafah. And this is not only for those people attending Hajj. It was for all of the people on the day of Arafah that they would get their du'as answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, it was reported that some of the pious predecessors used to say that there was not a single du'a that I used to make in the day of Arafah, except that I would find that within the whole year, Allah would accept it. Especially Ashiyah. The Ashiyah, the time of Ashiyah. What does Ashiyah mean? Meaning the time after Asr, on the day of Arafah, after Asr until sunset. That particular, what is that, 2 hours, 3 hours duration only, if you can concentrate your du'as in that time, then you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepting it, and you will find most definitely Allah Rabbana Jalla Jalalu will answer it before the next year even comes. Not a single du'a except that Allah accepts. In fact, it was reported that Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, he spoke to his students and he said, do you know who is the worst of people on this day, oh my friends? He said, no, tell us, who is the worst people on the day of Arafah? The worst people on the day of Arafah are those people who think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept their dua, will not answer their dua. Worst people, can you believe that? The best of people are those who think that Allah will accept all their dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me and you from those people who benefit from this day. Ya ikhwati, in the authentic hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said the 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah are days in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves every deed more than even jihad in His cause, except for a person who has lost everything, his wealth and his health and his self, everything in jihad. But even jihad is not more beloved to Allah than good deeds that we do in this day. So even a subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, these small deeds are more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than any other deeds at all. And so it is therefore imperative that we spend every single moment of these 10 days in remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as possible, in reciting as much of the Quran as possible, in giving as much sadaqah as possible, in helping our neighbors, in being good to our parents, in being charitable towards our orphans and to our needy. It is important that you spend all of these 10 days in every act of ibadah that you can fathom, that is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to make a Muslim happy, or to remove one of his debts, or to feed a hungry Muslim, or to help your brother in a need that he has. So if you can do these two acts of good, if you can find the people that are sick and visit them, if you can find the dead and the dying and visit them and look after them, if you can find the orphans and spread khair amongst them and the needy and give them charity, then these are the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make a Muslim happy and Allah will make you happy on the day that you meet him. In one authentic hadith, it was reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said that if you could remember Allah all the time, then the angels would descend upon you and they would kiss you on your forehead and they would shake your hands and they would greet you and tell you of the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best of deeds, that is even better than striking the necks of your enemies and them striking yours. What is it, Ya Rasulullah? The Sahaba asked. The Prophet said that your tongue be moist with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keep your tongues moist with Allah's remembrance. Spread the khair. In fact, I'm recording this on the day of Dhul Hijjah, on the first day of Dhul Hijjah, so that I can also benefit from the ajr of this day, inshallah ta'ala. And you can also benefit from the remembrance that you receive and the reminding that you feel, inshallah ta'ala, the good deeds that you do from this remembrance on this day of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, take advantage of it. Write down your du'as. Write them down, find the best of times, and make sure you increase in it as much as possible. And especially from one type of ibadah that I want you to take advantage of, and that is the fasting. You know, fasting has a special place in Islam. And the reason why fasting has a special place is because of the hadith which is in Sahih Bukhari, where the Prophet ﷺ said, "As-sawmu li wa ana ajzi bih." And this is the hadith which is Hadith Al-Qudsi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fasting is for me and I will reward according to it. And ana ajzibi, and I will reward according to it. So the scholars of Islam said, asawmu li means that fasting is purely for Allah, therefore it can never be taken away. In fact, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, in his explanation of this hadith, he mentions that every other act or ibadah, such as your sadaqah or even your dhikr, can be taken away from you on the day of judgment. So someone, for example, will come and say, you know what, oh Allah, this man insulted me, this man took my deeds, this man stole from me, this man hurt me. So Allah will say, okay, take from his deeds. So they will take some of your charity, some of your dhikr, some of your salah, some other acts of ibadah, some hajj you've done, some umrah you've done, according to how bad you have been to that person, will take your deeds away. Except for fasting, he will not be able to take away. I mean, imagine you become bankrupt, right? When you become bankrupt, they'll take your car away, they'll take your wealth in your bank account away, but they can't take the house in which you live, right? Because if that were to be taken away, you would be totally naked on the street. Nor can they take your shirt away or your pants away. The same stuff that you need to live and survive. They can't do that, even if you become bankrupt, correct? So in the same way, even if you become bankrupt on the day of judgment, your fasting will never leave you. It can never be taken away. So therefore, the prudent person is the one who builds his mansion that can never be taken away, his castle that can be never taken away, his deeds that can be never taken away. So your fasting, make use of your fasting, increase in the number of fasting, because it can never be taken away. Every other deed can be taken away except for your fasting. And which better time to do your fasting except the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, or the 9 days of Dhul Hijjah, the 10th being haram to fast, because it's a day of eating, and which is from eating from your slaughtering. So it's haram to fast on the day of Eid. But all of the 9 days, fast as much as possible, brothers and sisters. And if you're going for Hajj, of course you're not going to fast on the day of Arafah or on the day of Nahar, which is slaughtering, but you can fast on the days before. You can try to fast until the 8 days of Dhul Hijjah, even if you're going for Hajj. You should try to do that because of the greatness of the blessings of this day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless me and you to fast every single day and to continue to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his ibadah in these 10 nights. My brothers and sisters in Islam, these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are ours. they are something which our ummah has been given.